Yay, caramba. 13 minutes after the hour of 12 noon. A very good Friday to you. Friday, November the 12th, 13th, 11th. 11th, that's what it is. Friday, November the 11th, right here at the radio station. Of course, that means anything goes Friday, which is a very clever ploy that Lassiter has developed to get himself consistent three-day weekends. So let me give you the telephone numbers this morning, actually. Driving down Bayshore Boulevard, and I'm thinking about the week that has just gone by and what I'm going to do today and what I might do next week. And suddenly I said, well, wait a second. This guy Mel from Mel's Hot Dogs called last week and promised to bring us a whole lot of hot dogs, but he didn't do it. Gee, I wonder if I'll show up today. About 10 minutes to 12 this morning, I'm standing in the production room listening to some things. Down the hall comes the aroma of some of the most gorgeous, some of the most fantastic, some of the most delectable hot dogs that a poor nose could begin to imagine. And it was Mel with a box full of hot dogs. It's unbelievable. Mel's Hot Dogs, where are they? Boulevard, one block east of Busch Garden. Mel's Hot Dogs. Oh. You won't mind if I repeat a little bit during the program today, I hope. Let's go to Jeff in Clearwater. Jeffy, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hi, Rob.
Hi, Jeff.
How you been, man?
Well, fine, Jeff.
I wanted to ask you about wrestling.
Well, what did you want to ask me about wrestling, Jeff?
I want to ask you if you ever did.
If I ever did. Yeah, in high school, I did.
You did?
Yeah, that's what I believe I just said, yeah.
Well, that's far out, man.
Yeah, it is far out, Jeff. Mark in Tampa. Mark, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hello, yes, am I on?
Would I put you on?
Yes, I wanted to comment on that, well, what I considered the survey, but you considered the Hall of Fame yesterday.
Uh-huh.
And stuff, I thought it was pretty interesting. Also, the amount of people that called not liking the wrestling bit, remember?
Uh-huh.
And stuff, you know, but overall, I thought it was a good survey for like the first half an hour, but then after that, it sort of got a little boring.
Well, I guess that's why I've got the show and you don't.
That's right, bye.
Bye. Let's see, was that, no, I've gone and done it. Let's do that. And then we'll do that. And say hi there, Jeff in Temple Terrace. Jeff, you're on the air 970 WFLA. Mm-hmm. Let's get with it, Jeff. It's a rating period, you know?
Bob.
Yeah, Jeff.
I love you still.
You love my what, Jeff?
Bob, I love you.
You love me. Great.
Yeah. It is great.
Mm-hmm.
Bob, I love you.
Jeff's getting a big kick out of hearing himself on the radio. It's the only possibility that Jeff could ever have in his entire life of hearing himself on the air, because obviously nobody else would put him on.
Right.
Oh, now I'm a jerk. I thought you loved me.
No, Bob, I said you're exactly right.
Oh.
You hit the nail right on the head.
Uh-huh.
Again.
Yep, I usually do.
Very good.
Mm-hmm. Is that about it, Jeff?
Yeah, that about wraps it up.
Well, I'm sure it does for you. 9-9, God, we love Anything Goes Fridays, especially following an exciting show from Sam about, you know, what am I eating? Hey, even I can come out from underneath that. Jerry in Indian Rocks. Jerry, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
How you doing, Bob?
Oh, just great, Jerry.
So, you still sympathizing with the commies?
No, I don't believe I ever have, Jerry.
No, I'm just joking with you.
Mm-hmm.
So, where's Captain Jack and Rocky? I ain't heard of them.
I imagine they're home, Jerry. They don't normally check in with me to list their whereabouts.
Well, they call you most of the time, you know.
Well, I believe Rocky has called me once in 9 months. Captain Jack, perhaps five times in a year.
Well, that's really all I wanted, Bob.
Oh, okay, Jer. Well, you know, it is, you know, anything goes Friday. Oh, my. What I have inherited. This is incredible. One line available in, where is it, Hillsborough? Ludd in Plant City. Ludd, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hello, Bob.
Okay, I've tried before with you people, so now let me really lay it on the line. The Lionel impersonator is absolutely brilliant. It is an incredibly brilliant shtick. Don't you feel sorry, whoever the hell you are? Don't you feel sorry for yourself that you can't come up with something original, that you got to steal somebody else's shtick?
Bob, you're a fine American.
Yeah, well, you're a jerk. Get off my phone. Bob, that's why I told you there'd be a line available in Pinellas. Bob in Newport Richie. Bob, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hey, good afternoon, Bob.
Good afternoon.
Yesterday, around 2:30 or so, I actually yelled at everybody coming in late, which is pretty funny, actually. He had mentioned that.
What do you mean it's pretty funny? You don't think I meant it?
No, I'm sure you meant it, but it got me rolling. I was in my car. And it was terrible.
That is somewhat of an amusing concept.
You had mentioned the Halloween show that was so bad. You were so upset. You just did one of these deals.
Oh, God, I was devastated. Now, they were talking about a year ago, Halloween.
You were talking about the devil that...
No, that was a year ago. And
I got
to reminiscing about Brown's pumpkin.
Oh, okay. Because I listened to that show, and I'm usually working. I'm off today because of the holiday, and I haven't had a chance to call you. And I did have a question about that devil show for you.
Yeah.
Okay? And the question is this. You said that people always misrepresent what you say, but hey, you can knock this into stone. I'm saying that today I'm thinking about...
Ain't no devil. You got it.
Right. There is no devil. Okay. And you said, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, you said that although you don't believe in the God of the Bible or anything, you have your own, you do believe in God, but it's your own, you know, personal understanding of him.
Yeah, I'm basically what you would refer to as a deist, but nobody knows what the hell a deist is.
Okay. But what I'm saying is that you're not using the Bible as any authority, you're not using the Quran, you're just using, you know...
That's right.
Okay, fine. If you believe in a God, okay, and I guess I'm an agnostic. I mean, I would love to believe, you know, but I just don't, you know, and I don't disbelieve, you know. I can't prove it, so you know, I just don't know, you know. But what I'm saying is, that if you believe in a God, you believe in a supernatural, which sort
not
of
necessarily.
Like, okay, what? Excuse me.
Not necessarily.
Well, okay, maybe you could explain that because it's not supernatural. It's not supernatural, maybe just beyond what you can explain according to the laws that we know now.
Okay, I'm a little bit more comfortable with phrasing it that way.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, so supernatural says to me that you can make, you know, lead levitate and read people's minds, and that's what the word supernatural says to me.
Right, and that might be accurate in common usage. I simply meant it beyond the rules that we have set up now, you know, to explain things in the world. We really can't explain or prove of a God. So it's a matter of faith and it's a matter of belief. I'm telling you guys...
I've changed my mind, but go ahead.
There's no devil, okay? How can you, in good faith, and since you said you were serious that day, and don't call up and act like a jerk, and don't make believe you're a devil, I'm dead serious, unless that was just shtick.
No, I was serious.
Okay, if you're dead serious about that, how can you then say that there is no devil? I see him as going part and parcel. If you accept the existence of the possibility of a supernatural as we understand that, use it up.
No, I accept the possibility of supreme beings.
Right.
I accept no possibility of supernatural.
Evil. This is, our interpretation of that. That could not be part of the larger whole that we're not aware of?
No, I'll answer it for you a second time. No, they are both so flawed in concept that they are obviously the creation of man. Mm. They both have very, very specific purposes in life. One is to give hope to the hopeless so that they won't come and, you know, sack your castle.
Right.
The other is to explain away your own wrongdoing. Well, gee, it was the devil that made me go to that motel and take my clothes off and masturbate, even though I'm a, you know, renowned evangelist. Yeah, it was the devil. Yeah, that's the ticket.
You know, I was raised a Catholic, and I went through the whole thing. Went to Catholic grammar school, Catholic high school, went to St. John's, you know, the whole bit, right? And I can never really remember, except for, like, some very rudimentary... Until I got to college, right? But certainly grammar school and high school. The force of the devil wasn't really taught. What was taught was sin. And sin was seen more as a human failing. That you should try to limit that.
Yeah, but sin was also punished in hell, where the devil took great glee in getting fallen away Catholics so that he could stick them with his pitchfork and turn up the heat.
Well, you're 10 years older than me, Bob. You're 43, right?
Mm-hmm.
So right when Vatican came out, like in the early 60s, I was still in school, and maybe, you know, because she was just getting out of it, right? But I wonder if that had an effect on it, where it really toned everything down. Because I can recall that even that there was very little fire.
Well, the teachings of the Catholic Church have constantly changed. They're changing today, they changed yesterday, and they'll change tomorrow. Because the teachings of the Catholic Church have to keep in step with society and the level of education in general. Otherwise, the stuff becomes laughable. You know, such as you're going to rot in hell forever if you eat meat. And the reason for that was Christ was crucified on Friday. And so therefore on Friday you don't eat meat to show some type of reverence or respect. Well, remember when that credo came into being, first of all, it was damn tough to get meat. Only rich people ate meat, red meat. Poor people ate fowl and fish. So it was really no big deal. Hey, you know, I'm not going to eat caviar tonight.
Yeah, right.
I don't like caviar and I can't afford it. And I don't have any anyway. So isn't that a great way to show my respect?
Hey, Bob, it took a bit of time. I'm sure there's a couple of people that want to get on the line and belch at you or something. So, hey, thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you, Chuck. Line available in Rocky. You're on the air at 970 WFLA. Rocky, I guess you didn't hear the LUD call.
Are you face man?
Get off my phone, you jerk. Let's see. Where do you want me to go next? Okay, Chuck in Thanonasassa. Chuck, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Okay, I've just got a minute. I'd like to make a comment, and then I'm going to have to get off. But I'd like to make a nomination for the best show that I've heard. That was your program with Richard Dortch, and the reason is not because I'm in any way of similar background religiously or whatever, but I'd had two or three bad years and was just about ready to give up on myself. And I thought, if he can make it back after all that he's been through, I can make it back. And those few months in between have been some of the greatest of my life, and I'm on the way back.
Glad to hear it, Chuck. And you're right. Anybody can.
Thank you, sir.
Be good. Well, Jim and Holiday. Jim, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Yeah, afternoon, Bob. How
afternoon, are you? Jim. Fine.
Just two real quick questions I want to ask you, and I've been listening to you for a while. What would you, if you could be anything in the world, what would you like to be?
Exactly what I am.
Exactly what you
Precisely
are.
Precisely what I am. I'm extreme. This is a lifelong dream come
anything,
true.
Bob. Anything at all.
No, exactly what I am. It's a lifelong dream come true.
Now, something else. I heard you say here a couple of weeks ago that you are not a leader and you would not want to be a leader.
Nope.
Why?
It's just not within me. I'm a skeptic. I'm a cynic, and I constantly change my mind about things because I'm constantly reassessing. I would be a horrible leader. I mean, first of all, it would be, follow me to the east. Then we get halfway to the east, and I'd sit down and say, well, geez, you know, what's wrong with the follow me to the north?
Yeah, but we always got to reevaluate our position. Just what you've said again before, you've got to reevaluate your position.
Yeah, well, that makes for a real bad leader, you see. It makes for the kind of leader that people lose confidence in a real hurry.
Mm-hmm.
And on top of that, I'm an only child. I'm a classic only child. I enjoy being by myself or, at most, in the company of one or two people with whom I am extremely secure and familiar. And I do not...
You're a survivor,
you know,
and you're not selfish.
Most of the people who do what I do successfully are loners. Sitting here talking to something in the neighborhood of 100,000 people over the course of this afternoon, because I'm, in essence, sitting in a room all by myself, I can see one other human being on the other side of the glass with whom I am reasonably familiar and comfortable. So it's perfectly fine for me to sit here and go through my little fantasies and let my ego run wild and let my emotions go here, there, and the other place. It's real easy because it's the way I grew up, sitting in a room.
I understand.
By myself, amusing myself.
I understand. Okay, well, you have a good weekend. I got one little joke for you, Bush quail joke.
Okay.
You can go on the air. You want to hear it?
Sure.
President-elect Bush called Vice President-elect Quail, and he said, Dan, he says, let's keep the talk small. And Dan says, well, fine, George. He said, what should we talk about? He said, your IQ.
Oh, my goodness.
I knew you'd like this.
Thank you.
Have a good weekend, Bob.
Take care. Blood in Plant City, you blew your dime. So now we'll go to... Now we'll go to, are you trying to tell me that was the real LUD? Oh, mercy. That was the real LUD? Oh, he's still there? Oh, okay. Well, I didn't know it was the real LUD. Okay, LUD in Plant City.
Bob.
This is the real LUD, yeah.
This is LUD.
Hi, how you doing, LUD?
I'm back.
You're back. I thought you were going to be gone much longer, LUD.
We had a car problem.
Couldn't have anything possibly to do with the Hall of Fame yesterday where you were, you know, voted the most favored caller.
You know, Bob, we was coming back, and I heard the tail end of that, and neither Merle nor I heard the final tally.
Final Tell. You know, I read it. I don't even know if I saved the damn thing. Let me see.
Dick Norman came in, and next thing you know, it was 3 o'clock, and Bill and I missed the whole tally.
Oh, wait a second. I'm going through my briefcases. I got out of my car yesterday. My briefcase was open, so everything fell out on the driveway. I don't even know if I saved
it. I'd like to thank personally everybody who's called up and shown support for me and Bill. I appreciate that tremendously. Y'all are fine Americans. And I appreciate all the young...
Son of a gun, I did save them.
The young people who try to imitate...
All right, Lud.
Rather Buchanan.
Yeah, hey, Lud, zip it. Zip it. Zip it, Lud. I've got the results here. The overall best station, let's see, it was FLA with 5, 10, 15, 23. Coming in second was the old WPLP with 13. Overall worst station. Hi, Shorty, how you doing? WTKN, now you're not listening. And let's see, the all-time best talk show host. There's no need to go through that. The all-time worst talk show host. Really not much of a competition here. It was Fred Mertz, excuse me, with 14 votes. Liz Richards had 6. Jack Wheeler, John Eastman, Savin' Sam, and Harry Cupp each had 2. Jack Ellery, Art Dineen, Richard Shanks, Drew Hayes, Kevin, Mike Levine, Dick Norton, and Dave Fowler each had 1. Best caller of the decade, which, of course, was you, Lud, with 10 votes. Second to Mr. Airstream with 5.
Excuse me, Bob.
Yeah.
You say I was second to Mr. Airstream?
No. You were first. Actually, that was wrong. Rocky was second. Mr. Airstream was third.
Do I win something, Bob?
Not a damn thing, Lud. Worst caller of the decade. That was Valrico Cookie tied with Carolyn. For worst caller of the decade with 5 votes each. Best show ever was Lassiter's Christmas show. Worst show ever was, let's see here, Fart with Fred, which beat out Liz's man-bashing show by 1 vote. Best loved person in Tampa Bay Talk. This is really weird. Let's see, that was Lassiter with 6, Webb with 5, Fowler with 4. I don't think the people understood that question. Most hated person. Here we go. It was a tie between Fred Mertz and Bob Lassiter. The people did understand that one. The Wish You Were Here Award, David Fowler with 18. By far and away outdistancing the people who tied for second, Mike Levine, Paul Gonzalez, and Richard Shanks. Strange company there. Yeah, and the Good Riddance Award. Hands down, 22 votes to Fred Mertz. As a matter of fact, the only person who garnered more than 1 vote beside Mertz would have been Fowler, who had 2. But, you know, 2 to 22, that's no contest at all.
Bob,
yeah.
Could you tell me how the callers did? You just mentioned me in the Airstream or whatever. Who else did all right?
Well, let's see. Lionel had 3. Jacob had 4. Oren had 1. TJ had 1. Captain Jack had 1. Carolyn, Robin, who I don't even know who she is. Valrico Cookie, the Rolling Pin Granny, and Stan the Money Man all had 1 vote.
Bob, why do you call Valrico Bob Cookie? I was away, apparently, when you started that new moniker.
Oh, well, that's because we've come to find that Valrico Bob, while indeed a former Marine and having spent a number of years in the Marines, spent them as a cook. And frequently in the military, cooks are referred to as cookie.
That's not true, Bob. He's a fine American. He fought for our country, Bob. In the Korean War.
I thought he baked for his country.
He is somebody that I would love to meet one day. And
peeled for his country.
And espouses.
And fried for his country.
Categories of people that make this country.
Stirred for his country.
A very virile country.
And washed up for his country.
I think you're jealous of him, Bob.
Jealous? Why would you say that, Lud?
Well, I think because he is a true patriot. I think what you're trying to do is merely... I think you doth protest too much. I think whenever somebody is able to explain their love of country...
Well, Lud, I was under the very distinct impression that you were going to be gone for, you know, the best part of a year.
Like I said, we had some trouble. We blew a gasket around Tuscaloosa. and blew a head or something. Merle needed to get a head or something for the car, so we just turned around and came back home.
Did Merle get some head?
You understand here what I wanted to tell you? Was that, Bob, you know, you did a show a while back about Satan. And I'm probably one of the only people around here who will admit to this, and I am absolutely serious when I tell you that Merle and I met Satan a while back. It was 5 years ago.
Lud, we just simply do not have the time to listen about the night that you and Merle both put away a gallon of white lightning between you. We just don't have the time to go into that, Lud, but I thank you ever so much for checking in with us. In Zephyr Hills, Kevin, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Howdy, Bob.
Hi, Kevin.
I'm deeply offended.
My God, I've only been on for 46 minutes.
Not even an honorable mention yesterday. Nobody ever listens to me.
Well, in what category did you want an honorable mention?
Any of them would have been fine. You know what P.T. Barnum said is any publicity is good publicity.
Well, Kevin, you must understand that this is, you know, a decade's worth of callers and shows and hosts and stations of very unique people.
Since it was invented, how many people out there actually remember Harvey Shelton?
Michael, where are you? I can't see Michael.
The man with double pupils.
Michael, do you remember Harvey Shelton?
I remember the name. I don't remember him. Remember, he went back to that...
Michael.
Went back to the station in Largo and tried to do a sports show for a while. Do you remember that?
Okay, was he on the list yesterday? Was he on the list of former talk show hosts?
I'd forgotten about him.
He was the original. He was the first. He claimed to be descended from ancient Egyptians who were descended from aliens because he had double pupils. But that's not what I called to talk about, Bob.
Well, I'm really glad to hear that.
Anyway, the reason I called is to talk about the stealth bomber. And, there are a few communists within the
Air Force. Whoa, set off the alarm. This is our first caller ever about the stealth bomber. Now, how do I turn the damn thing off? Excuse me
a second, Kevin. You've been anxious to hear this, haven't you?
Which button is it, Michael? Oh, okay. Go ahead.
There are some communists out there in the Air Force that actually want the public to know what the stealth bomber looks like.
No.
Yes.
Would you pick this up from listening to Tim Coles?
Yeah. Because if we know what the stealth bomber looks like, the Russians will know what it looks like. And if they know what it looks like, they might be able to see it coming. And if they see it coming, all those billions and billions of dollars that we spent on being stealthy will be wasted.
Oh, man, you just don't understand nothing. You're the commie. Exactly what they want to happen, Kevin. It's precisely what the administration and the Pentagon want to happen.
All right, let's go through a little thought experiment here, Bob.
Kevin, wait a second.
Let's think this thing through.
Exactly, that's what I'm going to help you do. Kevin?
I'm trying to help you, Bob.
There are, 57 of these babies?
No, there's projected for procurement 59. And they have
But they've already lost two.
They've lost two, yes.
So it's 57 total, I believe.
But there's seven in construction.
Okay.
Let's not piddle over.
All right. So 57 and 7 is 64. A mere 64 airplanes. Now, 64 truly invisible airplanes would probably be enough to take out the Soviet Union, correct? Each one carrying, a couple of nuclear bombs, it would probably be enough to take them out.
Only if they don't know that it's coming, because the deterrence effect of it would be worthless if they know what it looks like.
Kevin.
Okay.
If they were so good that they didn't know they were coming, we wouldn't any more of them, would we?
You don't understand
the true brilliance of it, Kevin.
Now they've
built all the damn stealth fighters that they can deal with. They don't need any more. So what's left to do? You give it to the Soviets so that you can go on to the next super secret, super expensive weapon system.
That's right, Reagan's plan for Star Wars. He's going to give Star Wars to the Soviets, not the stealth bomber. But back to the stealth bomber. Now, the stealth bomber has been scheduled for a rollout at least once now, and the cooler heads prevailed within the Pentagon, and they decided not to show it to the public.
No, the commies prevailed. They were the ones that said, no, don't show it.
Well, what would it look like at the stealth bomber rollout, Bob? Would you have
a large hangar,
crowds, congressmen, the TV news? Would they all be there?
I would imagine.
All right, now you got to really think this thing through to appreciate the true brilliance of the plan.
Of course, if they were really being brilliant, they would have, sort of done it as kind of the emperor's clothing. They would have just opened the hangar door, the hangar would have been empty, and they would have said, see? So that's the way they would have dealt with it if the government wasn't filled with communists.
You mean that when the greatest test pilot in the world, Chuck Yeager, gets out on the tarmac to take the first flight in the stealth bomber, and he puts on his invisible flight suit, and he climbs up the invisible stairs, and he gets into the invisible cockpit, and turns on the invisible engines with a sound so loud that no one can hear, that he might actually be sitting up there naked?
Now you're starting to catch on, Kevin. Uh-huh. That's why you didn't get any votes yesterday.
Kevin, I've got...
Man, I tell you, I'm too tired to take a call after all of that. But that's what we get paid for. We need the 43 cents, right? Laszlo in Dunedin. Laszlo, your turn at 970 WFLA.
Bob, does the name Ada B. Armstrong ring a bell with you?
Ada B. Armstrong.
She writes for the Suncoast Beacon, which is a little newspaper that serves Pinellas and West Pasco counties. Now, this is select communities, mind you.
Well, I can't say as though the name Ada B. Armstrong does ring a bell. I would think that had I heard it before, then I would have heard a... But I haven't heard it before, so I didn't hear a bell.
I understand. Well, it turns out that the Florida Shuffleboard Association had a meeting Saturday, October 22nd in Sebring.
Oh, those rascals.
I tell you, get a load of this.
Yeah.
One of the highlights of this meeting was an election for shufflers to the Florida Hall of Fame.
You're kidding me.
I couldn't make this up. Those elected were Mary Moore of Lakeland, formerly of Clearwater, Frank Berger Fort Pierce, formerly of Clearwater.
Wait a second. Are you trying to tell me that somebody formerly of Clearwater retired and moved to Lakeland?
Oh, it goes on. Charles Bone in Mount Dora, formerly of Clearwater. This is terrible.
What the hell is there? Some kind of an exodus from Clearwater?
I don't know. And it says, congratulations to these people who have done so very much to boost shuffleboard. May we find more like you.
Wait a second. No one in this market has done more to boost shuffleboard than I have.
And they want to find more people like them. Why don't they just look on I-75? They're on their way.
Or, hell, listen to my show, you know? And
yeah.
Gosh, I don't understand.
This stuff is great. Oh, and here's another thing.
Yeah?
Vince Crawford, president of the Clearwater Club, was notified officially that the 9th International Shuffleboard Tournament is going to be held at Clearwater in the week of... Oh, damn, we missed it.
Wait a second. Why are they going to hold it at Clearwater if all the shuffleboard people left Clearwater and went to Lakeland?
I don't know. Maybe they upped the tour bus industry.
And that doesn't make any sense to me. Now all these poor people have split from Clearwater. They've gone halfway across the state to Lakeland, and they're going to hold the shuffleboard tournament in Clearwater?
Well, now, maybe there's a reason for this, because we were chosen over Hemet, California, and Mesa, Arizona. But then those two cities have already had it, according to the article here.
Well, so to speak.
And one last thing.
Yeah.
B-team standings after 32 games, Southgate, Colonial Village, Lake Tarpon Village, all tied for first.
All right.
Hillcrest, Shangri-La, Cedar Creek, all tied for last.
Oh, Shangri-La's not having a good season?
No, they suck. Boy, you guys better get it together over there.
I mean, you know, they've had the top draft for the last 3 years. I don't understand. What in the hell's the matter with a coach at Shangri-La?
I can't figure it.
Wait a second. Let me see who's the coach at Shangri-La. Let me get the talk show host manual out here. One second, please. Don't go away, Laszlo. I'll be right back.
I'm here.
Ah, somebody put a damn talk show host manual all the way over in the corner. It's heavier every day. Ah,
I can't believe this is real. I'm reading.
Okay, Shangri-La. Ah, here it is. Okay, Vice President, General Manager, Tony Perkins. Guess who? Ray Perkins, coach of Shangri-La.
One last thing.
Yeah?
Southern Comfort did not play. They've got a 0%.
Well, hey, you know.
They must have been drinking the stuff.
Yeah.
See ya.
Be good, Laszlo.
Bye.
Now here's more with News Radio 970 WFLA's Bob Lassiter.
It's Friday and some people are confused. By Monday or Tuesday, they'll be clear-headed again.
6 minutes after the hour of 1 o'clock, welcome in second hour on a Friday, November the 11th, 1988. By the way, we do have just a few, tickets left over for the Wade Boggs softball tournament tomorrow. So if you would like those when you call in, yeah, just ask Michael. And we don't have too many left, so whatever. Be reasonably quick about it. We do have also two lines available in Hillsboro. Nice. It's a Friday. That means anything goes. Eduardo in Tampa. Eduardo, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Bob, it's very good to talk to you. After listening to your show yesterday, did Mike Sirio get any votes for best loved personality?
Mike Sirio, I don't think got any votes for anything.
Oh, that really is.
Wait a second. He's holding up his finger. One vote. Are you trying to tell me he got one vote?
Okay.
Most people use a different finger. Most people use the index finger, Mike.
I got to tell you something, Bob.
Yeah.
You turned me onto a really good sandwich over in Ybor City.
Continental Deli.
The Continental Deli.
Mm.
Went to there. I got the Cuban sandwich and the Spanish bean soup. It was a great.
I haven't tried the Spanish bean soup yet.
It's excellent. You're really missing something if you don't try it.
I will the next time I go in there, which will probably be in a week or two.
I should tell you that in all the ads that you've done for Howard's, you have neglected one of their biggest selling points to me.
What's that?
When you go into Howard's, when you go in the front door, they have these baskets, and they have cookies in the baskets that are the size of dinner plates.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And they have all kinds of muffins and biscuits and other kinds of stuff, too. All baked goods are dynamite.
That's true. But if you get one of the chocolate chip cookies that's the size of a dinner plate and a cup of coffee, that is a snack that will, oh, God.
Well, then let me recommend to this fine feast that you have already suggested a cup of their chocolate yogurt. It's like 100 calories, and it's almost as good as Häagen-Dazs. It is so rich and so chocolatey for a lousy 100 calories. You can't go wrong.
Bob, you and I think we think alike as far as sampling the good things that life has to offer.
You know, I would really much rather have food like we're talking about, cookies, yogurt, sandwiches, hot dogs, burgers. I would really much rather
have a big meal.
You got it. You've got it.
Yeah, I would too.
I enjoy a sandwich more than I enjoy a steak. Good sandwich, and I've been so lucky. I found so many places that really put out dynamite sandwiches.
That's right. If you're taking on sustenance, there's no reason to draw it out. I mean, get it over with.
Right. Well, hey, but look, since we're giving free plugs all over the place, let's not forget Chubby's.
You know, I haven't been to Chubby's yet, and I've meant to go, especially
ham and cheese sandwich, man. If you don't have the ham and cheese at Chubby's, then you deserve to die a miserable man. That is. There are all different kinds of baked ham, okay? I usually would try to buy the $4 to $5 a pound ham, boiled ham, I should say, not baked, boiled ham.
Right.
Chubby's must be $12 a pound ham. It has so much flavor. Oh, God. Oh, if you love ham, you'll love the ham and cheese sandwiches.
Well, you know, I must confess, I didn't know. I thought to myself, geez, would Lassiter lie to me? But, I mean, if you tell them the truth, and so I tested you by going to the Continental Deli, and that turned out to be a great tip.
It turned
out to be really good.
It is,
and it's got a.
Try to sit down and talk to Al when you're there the next time. The guy's got an incredible story to tell you.
He was talking to somebody else when I came in, but there's a beautiful picture of Ted Webb on the wall.
Yeah.
Which let me know right away, this is my kind of place.
Well, I don't know. It was the picture of Webb on the wall that kind of made me leery.
And it's a, I mean, he's got that eyebrow raised, that sort of knowing look, like, yes, I've been here, and this is a good place to be.
Well, Teddy's, Teddy's photo studio is just up the street. Besides, Teddy grew up in that neighborhood, too.
I saw that. I saw his photo studio. I've been listening to WFLA for a long time. Listen, I've got a gripe with you about yesterday's show, though.
Oh, yeah? What?
You know, you had these categories.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't let people, give you, like, their second choice.
Well, sure I did. I just wouldn't include it.
Right, well.
I'm not going to get involved in half votes and one-third votes and seven-nineteenths of a vote.
But it could, for next year's induction into the Hall of Fame, those things could make a difference. I mean, in a market where John Eastman is still allowed on the air.
He is? I thought he was a TKN.
Well, that's on the air. I mean, nobody has a list.
Yeah, but it doesn't count.
In a market where Drew Hayes came up and then went on to whatever just reward it is that Drew Hayes found for himself, and in a market that fostered the likes of Richard Shanks and Art Dineen, you have to have at least, like, second and third choice for the worst of every category.
Well, you know, the talk show, the Tampa Bay Talk Show Hall of Fame is a permanent institution. It will remain for years and years and years and years. And it's such an honor to be inducted into it that I think some of these people deserve to wait several years before they can garner enough votes. Now, next time we have nominations, those people who have already successfully entered this time, of course, will not be eligible for additional nominations. So that will give people such as Shanks, Deneen, et cetera, an opportunity to also share in the shame, the fame.
Well, I suppose that's a pretty good explanation. I know John Eastman.
I do know John.
Pardon me?
Yes, I do know John. I actually even like John.
I'm sure he's a really nice guy personally.
Not particularly, but neither am I. I like John, though.
Oh, God.
You can't be nice and do this, too.
I don't know. You're probably right.
You want proof of it? Would you like positive proof that you can't be nice and do this, too?
Sure.
Richard Shanks and Art Deneen are very nice men. They are genuinely nice men. I enjoy both of their companies. Both of their companies.
But you enjoyed David Fallon's company, too. You said that once.
But he's not a nice man. I'm not a nice man. I'm not a nice man. I'm a terrible person.
Did Fowler once actually invite you to his house and then go up on the roof and say that he wouldn't come down until you left?
Yes and no. He did once invite me to his house, and the people that had Fowler's house before he did apparently had a wood-burning stove, and so there is in the living room roof, or ceiling as the case may be, which is also the roof, there is a little cutout that the chimney apparently went through, and that cutout was capped off.
Right.
And one afternoon I was sitting there, and a storm came up, and it blew, or threatened to blow, I guess it was, the top off of the roof.
Yeah.
And so Fowler had to go up onto the roof and replace it. And I was about to leave anyway, and as he was up on the roof, I left. And so I just slightly embellished the story to the point where he threatened not to come down until I had left. But yes, he did go up onto the roof. That's true.
Oh.
It's also true that I saw him standing out on his front porch, shaking his fist, cursing and hollering at the birds for chirping. They were annoying him. That is true.
He actually cursed the birds for chirping?
Yes. He's a mean man.
I've always thought that Fowler probably was a really nice guy to sit down over a beer with, and that, you know, he would be very entertaining, and I guess I've always equated
he is an extremely entertaining man. A trip to David Fowler's house was always a memorable experience.
But almost every story
I have ever told is basically true.
Okay, well,
probably the only one that was really embellished was the threat not to come back down off the roof. The others were pretty much exactly the way it happened.
Well, I remember that very well because as you told that, you had this way of...
Remember the story about just one more piece of pizza?
Yes.
That is a true story. I was dieting, and the Fowler said, well, let's send out for pizza. And I said, okay, yeah, but I'm only going to have one. They sent me home with most of the pizza. I ate almost all of it before I got home. I had about a 20-minute drive at that time from where he lived and where I lived.
Right.
And I was trying very, very hard to diet. I was doing so with a reasonable degree of success. But I'm a weak man. And the Fowler sent out for this great big pizza. It was one of these square Sicilian-type pies, as memory serves me. And David's wife, as I was getting ready to leave, I had the one piece. They probably had one or two between them. So the overwhelming majority of this very large pizza was left. And they sent it home with me. And I ate it before I got home.
Well, Dave is a small man, right? I mean, he's not a big fella.
No, he's not.
And one whose appetite probably is not that great.
No, David does not overeat by any stretch of the imagination. I'm sure that pizza would have lasted he and his wife 2 years. Didn't make it home with me.
Oh, wow.
And as I seem to recall, I stopped at the 7-Eleven and got more food on the way home that night.
Because they had already gotten you on a binge.
Right there. And I did an entire show the next day, and the show actually had a title. The title of the show is There Is No Such Thing As Just One More Piece of Pizza.
You used to have really, really great shows at
I used to have really, really great shows. Oh, you're really on a roll now with me, kid. What do you mean I used to have great shows? I didn't used to have callers like this. You know what I mean?
You used to have callers like, well, like that manic depressive lady in Pinellas Park. Do you remember her?
Gulfport baby.
The Gulfport. Yes. Gulfport, that's right. She would talk. She would carry on a monologue. You could go smoke a cigarette, go to the bathroom.
Well, no, actually, no, you're quite wrong. You would not dare leave. The thing is, at WPLP, the dump system recycled much faster than the one does here, because you would have to take out about every ninth word that the Gulfport baby put out or tried to put out over the air. You cannot do that here, which is why she does not get on the air here, with me anyway.
Has she tried to?
Yeah, a couple of times. But her language is such that even I cannot tolerate it.
Well,
I mean, this woman uses words I don't use in private.
Even when you're talking to yourself, huh?
No, not even when I'm talking to myself. I mean, she uses words that if I were to use talking to myself, I would blush.
Well, as a long-time talk radio listener, I must say that I'm a recent convert to you. When you were at PLP, I thought, geez, this guy is too liberal, and I couldn't listen to you. And now, I don't know. Maybe you grow on people like some sort of fungus. I don't know. But I, you know, I listen to you every day, religiously. And, well, I guess that's a good term for it. Yes, religiously.
You don't have to kneel before the radio while you're listening. You know, feel free to sit most of the time.
Thank you. Thank you, Monsignor. Although Dick Norman is still one that I can't take him every day. I have to space it out. It's got to be like a couple of days in between times. And this break from Liz Richards has been a godsend. But I have a real
It is a very strong argument for a deity.
But I have a real problem.
Come to think of it, Liz is a very strong argument for the devil.
Yes, she is. She is. She's like possessed of something. I'm not sure what. But I got a real problem, and I got to tell you this, then I got to go. Your friend... And maybe it's not your friend, but TJ. They call Sam McClellan.
Mm-hmm.
TJ in Clearwater.
Yeah.
That woman has got me so aroused. I don't know how it's happened, but I'm in love with the woman. TJ, if you're listening, this is Ed here, Eduardo. You can call me Ed. Call me. Really. The woman has got me hot. I mean, like a stove, I'm burning up. I don't know what it is that she's done exactly, what it is that she said, but oh God.
Thank you, Eduardo.
Thank you.
Take care. I don't understand people calling up and, you know, chew on my ear for 9 minutes about nothing and then say, boy, you don't have shows like you used to have before. The reason I don't is because you people keep blocking the lines for these befuddled old people that I used to have and rip to shreds. Jeez! Changed, unfortunately, talk radio in this market. For those of you who were around 3 years ago, you'll know what I'm talking about. But you see, unfortunately, most of you listening to this program weren't around for talk radio 3 years ago. 3 years ago, just to give you an example of the kind of audience and the kind of caller that we used to have, David Fowler would come on in the morning over at PLP. He was on from 9 to noon, and he would tell one of his patented stories. One of these tremendous, great stories out of his life that were basically true stories to the best of my knowledge. You know, not basically true, that were true stories. I would come on at 7 or 8 o'clock at night, take the same damn story that David had told, and slightly twist it and tell it as though it were my story. For example, David might have done his infamous banana suit story in the morning. I would come on at night and tell my lemon suit story. Well, the kind of people that we used to have listening and calling back then, these dear, sweet, sweet little old grandmothers would call me up and bitch and moan and accuse me of stealing David's story. I, of course, would deny it and become very, very you know, Huffy and accused Fowler of actually stealing the story from me, I'd say, well, gee, I was just over his house last night, and I told him the lemon suit story. And he said, gee, that's so great. Why don't you tell it on your show tomorrow night? Or that kind of thing. And then the following day, David would get callers from befuddled people saying, well, that Lassiter last night, he stole your story, David. And David would tell another story, and the thing would go on endlessly. And there were these tremendous callers. And it was so damned funny that more and more young people started to listen. And then the young people started to call. And then they blocked out the people that used to think that I stole Fowler's stories. And I've single-handedly changed the face of talk radio in Tampa. I didn't have to work back then. I didn't have to try to be funny back then. All I had to do was respond to these legitimate callers. Now, oh my God, this is like working in the mill here. Joe in St. Petersburg. Joe, you're on the air at 970 WFLA. Tell you what, Joe, I just decided to ruin your career in radio. Joe called up and burped, and I know that he's going to be rushing back to his radio to hear it, and what the hell, I decided to dump it. Let's go to Steve in Tampa. Steve, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hey, yeah. Bob.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Fine.
All right. What I wanted to talk about today was the conversion of Eisenhower Boulevard into a toll road, and how I don't believe that about 25% of Hillsborough County, which is basically the town and country area, should be financing the construction of a Northwest Expressway.
I couldn't care less. I live down around Bayshore.
Sir?
I said I couldn't care less. I live down around Bayshore.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, but I'm just saying that the whole purpose of the construction for the Northwest Corridor is to allow the higher-income families such as Carrollwood area and from North Tampa to have access to the south side of town. Mm-hmm. Now, granted, for that portion of the construction on the north end of the Northwest Expressway, they'll be paying a toll coming down the road. But Eisenhower Boulevard is already an existing facility out there in the county now, and I don't understand, with the passage of things like Amendment 4 now, why the lower-income people living in town and country have to pay for this roadway to be built. You know what I'm saying? It's not to our benefit.
Do I know what you're saying? Did you really ask me, do I know what you're saying?
You know, we're coming south out of town, because there's only two routes out of there. You know, you're pinched between the airport and the bay, Eisenhower and Hillsborough. And you can imagine what the traffic on Hillsborough Avenue is going to be like when they open this thing up. You see where I'm coming from? Yeah, you understand the point I'm trying to make. What I'm trying to say is, why can't we use Amendment 4 with the passage of this thing, you know, to help finance the roads?
Sir, there are 1.8 million people, roughly, who live in the general Tampa Bay metropolitan area.
Granted.
Of those 1.8 million, at least 1.5 million of them couldn't care less about what you're talking of. At least 1.2 million of them don't even know where you're talking about. They have no idea where Carrollwood is. They have no idea what Eisenhower... I live in Tampa, sir, and I don't think I've ever been on Eisenhower Boulevard. I couldn't tell you where it is. Hillsborough Avenue, I have a vague recollection of. But the overwhelming majority of people listening to this broadcast have no idea, A, what you're talking about, B, where it is, or C, why they're even listening at this point in the game. Captain Jack, Captain, welcome to 970 WFLA.
Good afternoon, Mr. Lassiter. I'd like for the 1.8 million to gather around the radio because I have something important to say. This is my last call to you.
No, it's not. You're not Captain Jack.
Yes, I am. Damn sure I am, Captain Jack, Bob. You with me?
Well, maybe when you start to scream a little bit, it sounds like Captain Jack. Okay.
I don't want to start screaming. I'm leaving, and I don't want you to get me all upset, and I got a few things I want to tell you. I'm leaving, and this is my last call.
Oh, okay, Jackie.
And I just wanted, you know, I just wanted to talk a little because I got to get out of town. I'm cutting out of here tomorrow.
Why do you have to get out of town, Captain Jack?
Well, it's a personal thing, Bob.
Come on, Captain. We know each other. You can tell me.
Well, I can't really, Bob. I can't do that. But all I can tell you is I'm leaving, and from what I understand, I'm just not going to have time. I'm going to be too old to coming back here.
There's no one that's too old to come back here.
Tell you, is it? I've enjoyed talking to you. I've enjoyed listening to your program. I think an awful lot of you. And I appreciate, you know, our discussions. We've had our ups and downs. And I appreciate the people out there. And while I'm at it, I want to put in a plug for Michael. I was on my way back from Naples Sunday, and I heard him on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a fine feller. And I'm gonna tell you something about that. That boy, he said on there that he has to have two damn jobs to even get to make a living. And you people up there making all that money, and you keep talking about minimum wage. Don't y'all ever tip anybody or help any of your own people out?
Tip him. I tip him every day. I tip Michael every single day. I said I tip him every single day, Captain. Captain?
Bob?
Yeah, Captain. I think there's something wrong with your phone, Captain. Captain's gone over to check his radio.
I can't hear you.
Well, there must be something
Michael,
wrong
are you
with
there?
Your... we'll put Captain on hold, see if Captain's phone works with you, Mike. In the meanwhile, we'll go to Tom in St. Petersburg. Tom, you're on the air at 970. Ah, pity-poo, Tom isn't. So let's try Mark and Brandon. That should be safe. Mark and Brandon. Unreal. How about Brian in Tampa? Hello, Brian in Tampa. Oh, Brian and Tampa's gone, too.
What happened here all of a sudden?
Well, I don't know. How you doing, Cleveland? You okay over there today? I don't have names down there.
TJ, line 6.
Okay, TJ, line 6. How are you, TJ?
Hi, Bob.
Oh, hi there.
I just walked into the house, and I turned on the radio. My goodness, I heard that poor Ed pining for me. I don't know what to do about that.
Well, I guess you might ask your husband, you know, if he'd mind, you know.
Yeah, I think he would not totally appreciate that. But anyway, you know, I really have nothing else to say today, but I was just really shocked. That's all I can say. And I did ask Michael for some tickets for tomorrow, so I'll probably be there. Incognito, of course.
Okay.
All right, Bob.
Okay, take care there. All right, we've gone from an absolute full board to an absolute empty board. And let's see, we've already played Conga. We've played the Lord's Pledge. What could we possibly do at this point in the game? Master Daniel's Prayer. Now, Master Daniel's Prayer, you basically had to be there to understand what that's all about. Okay. Oh, ta-da-ta-ta. Bum-bum-bum-bum-bum. Ah, there's a call. Steve in Riverview. Steve, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hi. Listen, about a month ago, I had just bought a puppy, boxer dog. I know you just said about the 1.8 million people not caring, but I thought to myself, it's a pretty rotten thing to do. It's a boxer pup. And if anybody really cares out there or has got a boxer they don't really care for, I'll take them.
Well, Steve, you see, maybe that's the way talk radio used to work, but... We don't do the swap shop or anything, you know, even similar to that on this program.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
Hey, no,
my message was a
no problems.
Pretty rotten person out there.
Okay.
All right, bye-bye.
Take care there. Jim in St. Petersburg. Jim, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. I'll be here till 3.
Okay. The reason I called, this is kind of a different question for you, but I was curious as to how the radio stations can determine... their ratings. Like, for instance, I know you folks, you know, you have phone calls that come in.
That has nothing to do with ratings whatsoever.
Nothing.
The ratings are determined by primarily two services in this area. One is called Birch, which does a monthly survey and is generally not considered to be that reliable because of the wild fluctuations in it. The other, the more reliable of the two, is called Arbitron. Arbitron surveys in this market approximately 48 weeks a year, 48, 49 weeks a year. The only times they are not surveying, the only times we're not in a rating period are roughly the middle of December through the middle of January, and then 1 week in September, towards the latter third of September. Otherwise, it's a rating period constantly in a market this size. The way it is done... Primarily, not exclusively, but primarily, the way it is done is that Arbitron will send a household a letter asking them if they would like to participate in the ratings. If they return the letter, then Arbitron will send them a diary that they will keep for a one-week period of time, indicating which stations they listened to, when they turned it on, when they turned it off, and exactly who was there listening. In other words, you know, child 9 years old, male 17 years old, male 41 years old. That information is taken back, tabulated, fed into a computer. It is a sample of, in this market, of approximately 2,500 people, approximately 2,500 diaries. What they do then is, using U.S. government census figures, they will break down, let's say, for example, 20, we'll make the numbers nice and easy, 20% of the population in this market is 25 to 30 years old. And they will then weight the diaries of people in that 25 to 30-year-old category according to what percentage of the overall population they represent. Am I losing you? Is this getting a little too bizarre? Because I hardly understand it.
Okay. And
so it is a sample of 2,500 diaries weighted by the population age, the demographic breakdown.
Okay. And the same thing goes for, like, the music stations also, then?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Okay. Okay, I'd just like to say thanks, Bob. This is a first-time caller. I listen to you all the time.
Take care. Thanks, Chris, bye. In Clearwater. Chris, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hello, Bob. How are you today?
Oh, fine, Chris.
I just found out more than I ever wanted to know about ratings.
Well,
it's
a very, very complex situation. I don't even totally understand it.
Oh, I think you do. It sounds like you do, anyway. This is Anything Goes Friday?
Yeah.
I have a question that has been burning in my mind for a long time, and just a few minutes ago made me think of it again. What happens to the 7 seconds when you dump somebody? How come there isn't 7 seconds of dead air?
Okay, there used to be, because the way that the delay used to work, it was physically on tape. So that when you dumped something, all you were really doing is that it was a great big tape loop that took 7 seconds for it to go from one end to the other. So that when you dumped it, you literally took out those 7 seconds of tape. And consequently, you had nothing on the air but 7 seconds of dead air.
I understand.
Well, now, and this is even worse than the ratings, now it is electronically somehow, and I do not know how, it is electronically kept in a little box. I'm not kidding. So that when we dump it, in essence, what we do is we cut out the last 7 seconds, but we immediately go to live programming, and then the delay box starts to rebuild the delay. In other words, what it does when we dump it. Okay, I will give to the people at home. Jeez, I hope this works. I will give to you at home. You're not going to be able to hear it because you're on the phone.
Oh, thanks. I wanted to know.
I will give to the people at home an explanation as to how this works. I will push the dump button.
Uh-huh.
And then I will say utterly nothing for 7 seconds. But the people at home will not hear that 7 seconds. I am going...
Okay. I'm waiting. 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004, 1,005.
You are way too late. You see, they didn't hear you say, or they should not have heard you say, okay, I'm waiting, 1,001. See, because I started immediately. They picked up when you were about 5,000, 6,000.
Does it electronically slow your voice down a little bit, or what?
What it does is it takes, when the delay is being allowed to be rebuilt, what it does is it takes all of the pauses, like that one,
okay,
and eliminates them. So what I did is I gave it 7 seconds of pause all at once. Normally, in a conversation, I would hit the dump button and continue right on.
Ah.
I would not have sat here for 7 seconds.
So it doesn't have to worry about 7 seconds normally.
Right, and it might have taken 2 or 3 minutes for it to build back up again.
So if you dump somebody, if somebody said, you could still dump somebody right on top of dumping someone else if you had to, though.
If I allowed it to rebuild quickly.
Okay.
See, the system that they had at PLP, for some reason, and it was a very similar system, but for some reason it rebuilt much faster. We could get that baby back up to 3 or 4 seconds worth of delay in 10 seconds. This one, unless I sit here silent for 3 or 4 seconds, it would take probably the best part of a minute.
Well, you've
convinced me. This is a dangerous system to work with.
You convinced me of one thing. Magic is real.
I've asked the people in the engineering department to explain to me how it works, but my mind does not work that way. I cannot understand it.
Well, as long as it works, and I know that it does, I'm happy.
Okay.
Thanks, Bob.
Anytime.
Bye-bye.
Lionel, even though he has what appears to be a New York accent, is actually
Hispanic.
You're not the real Lionel.
Hey, it's Bob, and you know it.
You're the Lionel impersonator.
He's good.
You're the Lionel impersonator. And of course, I know you are now because you're saying the Lionel impersonator is good. The Lionel impersonator always messes up. You just messed up.
We got to get rid of him. He's starting to actually gain an audience. We got to get rid of him.
Michael, let's see if we can figure out how this dump button works one more time. Think we just did. Every week the guy gets through to me. I don't understand what it is. He fools me every week. Fred in Clearwater. Fred, you're on the air, 970 WFLA.
Hey, Bob.
Hi, Fred.
He can't fool you, Kenny.
Well, not for long.
Yeah, I've been keeping my clock. I'm keeping an eye on it, and I can tell that you're tracking him down. You're getting better every week.
Well, you know, he's suffering under this delusion that Lionel is really a New Yorker. Mm. And so, therefore, would know how to use all those Yiddish words.
His ethnic background seems to change every week.
I mean, like, even Lionel, this is how I should have caught him. Even the real Lionel wouldn't know what 3 weeks from Sukkot means.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lionel impersonator probably would.
Oh, yeah. You did that to him. You outsmarted him today, Bob.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
I want to talk about some talk show hosts, maybe draw our memories a little bit here.
Okay.
Question of Mr. Major, did he not work for WDAE years ago?
I think so, but I wouldn't, you know, this is long before I got to this town, but I think he did for a while.
Yeah, not my favorite. That is him. I can still remember him coughing into the microphone like he does. Almost like he was choking, and that's what he's best known for, even down in Miami when he left that area now, I guess.
No, he's still living there. He's not working, though.
Yeah, well, you know, maybe they call him in every now and then. They get rid of Kane or somebody down there. He'll sub-rate in there. They still like him, I guess.
No, actually, he did quite poorly.
Yeah,
he did very, very poorly, yes.
Oh, they
changed Stan's act completely. When they brought Stan back to follow Neil Rogers on INZ AM, what they did is they hired him and said, we want you to be another Neil Rogers.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, not do any serious topics, not do any guests, just, you know, come in and do shtick every day and, you know, play a lot of recorded bits, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, as long as Neil was on the AM, it more or less worked. Stan had roughly half of the numbers that Neil had. Then when they took Neil off the AM and put him on the FM and left Stan all by himself, he took that half that he had and cut that in half.
Yeah.
And then they decided that Stan Majors wasn't any good after they had already changed his act on him.
Right.
And as so often happens in this business, then they fired him for being what they wanted him to be.
They wanted to control the outcome, actually.
Exactly.
Right. They dictated what he wanted to do.
Right. And then after they decided what should be done on talk radio and who should do it, and it bombed, then they decided talk radio didn't work anymore, so they stopped doing talk.
I can remember Major here when he was in the Tampa Bay area. They gave him freedom to a point, but then again, things started to change. Well, I can remember his shows we'd call, and you'd only get 10 words to say, and it better be good, you know? Even then, he'd hang up on you whether it made sense or not, you know? But that developed his notoriety. He was really one of the first to do that. I mean, he was more or less carrying a conversation with himself. He'd call up, you'd get 10 words to say, make it quick, then he'd... You'd hang up a little bit, or he'd hang up on you, then he'd criticize you for half an hour.
I think he might have been on to something.
Yeah, exactly. You know, but I just have to say today, as I called you before and mentioned, the dean of the talk show host is Mr. Alan Burke, without question. What he's done in the Miami area, he's definitely the kingpin down there. And
Are you serious?
I am serious.
Alan Burke never had higher than a 3 in Miami, and he just got fired again.
He did?
Yes.
When was this?
When WIOD hired Neil Rogers. And fired Burke a week ago.
A week ago? Hey, but he was only there for 5 weeks then, right?
That's right.
That's amazing. Hey, maybe you can come up here?
I doubt it very much.
Yeah, I'd have to say the best caller, I'd have to say, is Connie Mack. In the morning when he called Mr. Gardner, suddenly he had a previous engagement. You might remember that.
Unfortunately, previous engagement seems to... Well, that's beside the point. Fred, I got to run. Charlie Davis standing by with a WFLA news brief. Radio 970 WFLA is joining with Channel 8 for the 6th annual Food for Families Drive, and obviously, again, we need your help. contribute your non-perishable food items, would you please just look for the big red and yellow barrels at participating Publix, Cash and Carry, Winn-Dixie, U-Save, and Piggly Wiggly stores. For more details, call the office here at News Radio 970 WFLA. Elmer in Pinellas Park. Elmer, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
I was in the Philippines in 1945, and I seen a woman that had a uterus the size of a dinner plate.
Yeah.
Now, what do you got to say about that?
Not a hell of a lot, Elmer. Most of the things I could think of would get me into more trouble than I'm willing to risk. So what do you have to say about that, Elmer? Oops, I guess Elmer hung up. Tom in Lutz, that's very strange.
How are you, Bob? I want to talk on the Trilateral Commission. And I have a paper here in front of me, Bob, that says right here.
I wanted to
Roy in Clearwater. Roy, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Afternoon, Bob.
Afternoon, Roy.
First time caller. Just wanted to say before I get started, you're about the only reason I listen to the talk radio during the day while I'm driving.
You're kind and I appreciate it.
Okay, what I was wanting to do, I was wanting to ask you your opinion on the hostage situation overseas there.
Mm-hmm.
When I was in the service and I was in Korea, I went up on a tour of the Panmunjom, the Peace Village. They made me sign a release form to go up there, and which meant if I got hurt or killed or kidnapped, that was my problem. Now, all these hostages, they're saying all this about we should be saving them. I don't think it's our responsibility. We didn't send them over there. We didn't ask them to teach over there.
Well, for openers, doesn't seem to be anybody officially doing anything about it anyway, so
I agree,
which problem?
They keep slandering us like that, you know?
No, I don't think they're slandering us. If you were being held captive by some lunatics, I think you'd, hope that somebody would get you out.
I heard that. It just, how do you feel about that? I mean, doesn't kind of get you once in a while?
Doesn't what get to me once in a while? I'm very well aware of that.
Yeah,
that's a crazy world you live in.
Yeah, it is a weird world for sure. Well, that's about all I wanted to ask.
And those people are entitled to the same amount of protection, I suppose, as any American citizen is overseas, which is very minimal. And you know what the hell? We can't protect ourselves here at home from ourselves. So how can we give full protection to someone in Lebanon?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously.
I heard that they're all a bunch of crazy fools over there.
But I certainly don't blame some guy that's been held captive for 3 years for, hoping that somebody will do something to get him out.
I can't blame them there either. But
nor do I blame their families.
It just seems kind of... They're always saying that...
Well, you must remember that 8 years ago, some guy came, riding into town on a horse saying that this kind of stuff wouldn't happen if he was president, saying that, he would go to any length to release a hostage.
Yeah.
He was shooting off at the mouth. He didn't mean it when he said it. He doesn't mean it now. He never did mean it. But there are an awful lot of people who took him at face value, and they believed him.
Mm-hmm. But there's only so much he could do, though. Don't you agree with that?
Well, the people should have realized when he was saying this crap that there was nothing he could do about it, but nonetheless, they chose to believe him, and they chose to put him in office.
That's true.
So now they're a little bit disturbed that he isn't doing anything about it.
Yeah, I get kind of perturbed that everybody wants to blame it on the president or on the government. And is it
who wants to blame it on the president?
I don't know. It seems like the press and everybody, they're giving a
hard
time.
I beg your pardon, sir. No, 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 no.
Now, well, it just gets to me sometimes, I sit around there. Terry Waite, all them are. What was Terry Waite was the one that went over and said, I'm going to go help these guys, and he got captured himself, right? Or no, it was the other guy, right?
You're talking about the envoy from the Church of England.
Yeah, that guy. All right.
More with News Radio 970 WFLA's Bob Lassiter.
It's Friday, and some people are confused. So, but by Monday or Tuesday, they'll be clear-headed again.
Minutes after the hour of 2 o'clock. Welcome back. Third and final hour on Friday, November the 11th. Veterans Day, 1988. Sometimes it's not easy being the mad dog. I don't know about anything goes Friday. I mean, it worked for so long, and it's weird. It's like pulling teeth anymore. I don't know. So many people think this is an easy job. It's not. Two lines open, which means I've got a board full of buffoons on there. But I'm an optimist. I'll go with the hope that those two lines will bring that magic spark. That at least one of them will be the call. The call that will be remembered forever and ever again. Maybe another Mr. Airstream. Maybe. Maybe a new South Side Johnny. Maybe a new Duncan. But with my luck, probably a Rose from St. Petersburg impersonator. But what the hell, the weekend's coming up, you know. Means I can sit out in the driveway on the dead cowskin seats in the Lincoln. Go vroom, 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 vroom. Turn the steering wheel, beep the horn. Mary said if I do all my chores, she'll let me take a ride on Sunday. Yeah, she wants to go to Point B. All these other troubles weren't bad enough. You see, when Mel from Mel's Hot Dogs came in here, he brought with him this humongous sack of popcorn. I mean, this baby's about 3.5 feet tall from corns a popping. And I had already put away a couple of Mel's Hot Dogs before the show, and so I said, well, gee, Mel, thanks a lot to all the good folks there at Corns a Popping. I appreciate it, and I'll probably get into this tonight at home. You know, maybe I'll sit out in the Lincoln eating it. To Bruce Williams on the radio. Mary doesn't think it'll run the battery down too much. But during the news break, I'm sitting here feeling kind of despondent. So I open the bag. Bad news. Why is it that you can't make popcorn at home that tastes like popcorn that somebody else can make? Like, you know, Corns a Popping, even a lousy movie theater. Same thing with hot dogs. You can't make hot dogs at home. The taste anywhere is near as good as the worst hot dogs that you can imagine getting over at a stadium someplace for $9. You just can't do it. Well, this stuff from Corns a Popping is going to kill me. It's incredibly good. But now, unfortunately, I've got teeth full of corn kernels and a thirst like you wouldn't believe. And a lust for more of this popcorn. Be a long, long hour. Well, I just turned over and looked around at the Fenortner. Those two lines I spoke of, no new Mr. Airstream. Hell, don't even have a Rose impersonator on it. Both in Hillsboro and all the great calls I always came out of Pinellas anyway. We'll go back to the phones and, you know, see what kind of grief it brings me for this hour. Plenty of grief last hour. Lauren in St. Petersburg. Hi, Lauren. You're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Oh, poor Bob. You sound so depressed.
Oh, it's rough, Lauren. It's rough.
Well, I
the whole
I...
purpose of Anything Goes Friday was to give me a three-day weekend, you know?
Yeah. Well, I hope I can brighten it a little bit.
Okay.
I have something that you once said you'd kill for, and I have that on tape, too. You know, you're always saying that you don't
nude. You have nude pictures of Linda Ronstadt?
I couldn't show you those over the phone.
Oh, well, no. That's true.
But I want to play something for you.
Okay.
Okay, you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, I hope this works, because I'm not mechanically inclined either. Okay, here we go.
Okay.
Meg in Tampa. Meg here on the air, WFLA.
Good afternoon, Robert.
Good afternoon, sir.
I was inspired by a kazoo playing, so I made up a rap for you right here.
A rap?
About you and all of your callers. It goes something like this. You got your Val Rico Bob, you got your Tom and Luke, you got Lud and Glant City in his cowboy boots, you got Jacob and Clearwater worshiping God, you got Rocky the Klansman, who's just plain odds. You got Lionel and Ludlow and Orton Temple Terrace. You know that woman Caroline, she sure does scare us. When you argue with Bob, you know you just can't win. So it's just best to say, be good, my friend.
Do you like that?
Fantastic.
And listen, I'll send it to you, okay?
Would you really?
I promise I will. I'm a woman of my word, but...
All right, I'll put some of this popcorn in an envelope and send it back to you.
Oh, I'd appreciate that. But you know what I'd appreciate more?
Well, what's that?
Well, see, I have a friend that moved to Boston last spring.
Uh-huh.
Because you were moving to Boston last spring. And so he went up there with eager anticipation. You know, something like if you had Sophie sitting at your feet.
Right now he's stuck listening to WHDH. Yeah, whoa.
Well, he gave up on talk radio up there.
That's easy to do.
So if you were dangling your heavy rope gold chain in front of Sophie, it's that kind of eager anticipation.
Uh-huh.
And then you didn't go up there.
Yeah.
His world just caved in. So I tape your show every day and I send it to him. So he sent this back for me. So could you just kind of say hi and thank him? And
What's his name?
His name's Pete.
Pete.
Yeah.
You would like me to say, hi, Pete, thanks? I can't do that.
Oh,
no, that's sending a personal message over the public airwaves. And for me to say, hi, Pete, how you doing? Sorry I didn't make it to Boston, man. Hang in there. Things will get better. I couldn't possibly do that.
Oh, he'll be so disappointed.
Well, I wish there was something I could do.
Okay, well, thanks anyway.
Thank you, Lauren.
Okay, and I will get this in the mail to you, I promise.
Okay, I look forward to it.
Okay.
Be good. Sam in Spring Hill. Hi, Sam, you're on the air at 970.
Hello, Bob.
Yeah, Sam.
You're kind of letting me down.
I let you down? How's that, Sam?
Well, all my friends have come down here from Michigan now, and I've got them listening to you, and you're not bashing anybody.
What do you mean I'm not bashing anybody?
And well, I told them how hilarious this is.
Well, it's very hilarious, Sam, but, you know, it's
you
not something...
I thought you started out today when you were talking shuffleboard.
But it's not something that's done every single day, Sam.
Well...
As a matter of fact, Sam, when I get off today, I will be meeting with some people here at the station... And kicking around some ideas. Well, just let me tell you some of the things that I would like to see done here. I would like to see, for example, I'm looking around on the second cam. Okay. I would like a sack full of Canadian money so that I could give it away.
Well, I didn't go over to Toronto to get any of that. I should have got some.
You know, we're thinking of putting together a snowbird survival kit for residents that would include things like... Well, maybe sending somebody to Canada for the weekend so they would have an opportunity to spend their Canadian coins.
Mm-hmm.
Or giving out those little plastic door guards so that your paint wouldn't get nicked.
Mm-hmm.
You know, little things like that. I'd like to see T-shirts, get off my phone, you jerk. Or, you know, go home, brain damaged snowbird. You know, just little things like that. It's not done every single day. You see, the trick, Sam, in radio, and this, believe it or not, truly comes out of a disc jockey's handbook. The trick is... to do something just occasionally, you know, like maybe once a day, once a week, whatever, and then you get a reputation for doing it, and people...
I've done it once since I come back down, though.
And people listen to hear you do it again, so, you know, that way you hold them. Because if I came in here... I mean, first of all, it takes several hours to put together 10 or 15 minutes worth of brain-damaged snowbird slams. I mean, you know, you really got to sit down and think about this stuff. It's a lot of material.
Oh, yeah.
And you can't keep using the same stuff over and over again. So this way, you know, we lock you in, I'll probably do it again Wednesday at 2:30. So this way, you know, you're locked in until next Wednesday at 2:30 waiting for me to do it.
Okay, on a serious vein, you were talking about shuffleboard.
On a serious vein.
Do you understand?
Yeah, yeah.
And you were saying these Florida teams aren't doing any good even though they've had the top draft choices.
Right.
Do you think Hugh Culverhouse or even William Clay Ford have had anything to do with these drafts?
It's a distinct possibility, I would have to think. You know, Shangri-La is really having a lousy season, man.
Mm-hmm.
On paper, they've got the talent.
Well,
on paper, but it just...
Those Lions,
but you know, obviously, with Coach Perkins over there with the Shangri-La team, it's just not working.
Well, one thing for my Florida friends, I want to let them know I brought them down to good old Michigan flu.
Wednesday at 2:30, we'll bash Snowbirds again.
Okay, I'll have everybody listening.
Okay.
Thank you, Bob.
Take care. Ann in Reddington Beach, and you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hello.
Yes, Ann.
I was wondering why I haven't heard you salute the veterans today.
You were wondering why you haven't heard me salute... You were wondering why I haven't saluted the veterans today.
Right. After all, this is Veterans Day.
Yeah, I know it's Veterans Day, yeah.
Right.
Well, I'm in the habit of saluting veterans throughout the year.
Well, this is a special day. You should say something about the veterans.
I believe I mentioned it was Veterans Day. I believe I mentioned that, yeah.
You did?
Yeah,
well,
I did mention it.
I tuned in at 1 o'clock and I haven't heard anything.
Well, actually, it was after 1 o'clock that I did it.
Mention anything about Veterans Day.
It was actually after 1 o'clock that I mentioned it, yeah.
Oh, okay.
After
That's
1.
All I wanted to know, just so they were remembered.
Okay, Ann.
All right, thank you for...
All right, take care of them. You're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hello, Robert?
Yeah?
My name's Pat, and we're having a game. That'd be in March tomorrow. And I heard you were gay. Would you like to come out and join us?
No, as a matter of fact, I wouldn't, Pat. No.
Robert?
Yeah.
Is it true that Marilyn is a man?
No, it's not.
That's what I've heard.
Well, you heard wrong.
How come you live in Hyde Park where all the gay people live?
I don't live in Hyde Park.
Well, you hang around Kennedy Boulevard. Yes, you do live in Hyde Park, don't you?
No, I don't live in Hyde Park.
Where you live at?
Somewhat south of Hyde Park.
Well, you live around there, and you hang around Kennedy Boulevard. That's where all the gay people hang around.
No, I don't hang around on Kennedy Boulevard.
Yes, you do, Bob. Don't lie to me.
No, I don't.
Well, I heard that Marilyn is a man. You know, that really proves that female imposters can be successful female imposters, doesn't it?
You know,
what is it, Bob?
If I were trapped inside of a body, if I had a mind trapped inside of a body like you do,
yes?
That dislikes things, that is angry at things,
yes, Bob?
Dislikes people, certain individuals like me.
Bob.
And you're just totally incapable of getting to me in any shape, manner, or form. And the only possible thing that you can do is to come on the air and tell fibs that don't bother me. Don't bother anybody. What a tragedy, man. What a tragedy.
Bob, I don't dislike nobody. I'm gay. I like everybody. See, Bob, I've came out of the closet.
No. Pat. If you were really gay, you have a fear of being gay, obviously. But if you were really gay, then you wouldn't be trying to insult someone else by suggesting that they were gay.
Well,
but you obviously do have a fear of your own sexuality.
Oh, yes, Bob. That's so true. Bob, did you want to come?
I know it is.
Did you want to come?
So does everybody else now.
Did you want to come and join us?
Is it because of your small penis? Is that the problem? Are you afraid of the girls pointing at it and laughing?
Well, Bob.
Or is it your inability to maintain an erection?
It's all of the above, Bob. I used to play with myself in the closet.
Uh-huh.
But I've came out of the closet, and now I play with myself outside, and I come on the radio. I tell everybody I'm gay. Isn't that so fantastic, Bob?
It's really a tragedy that you just don't understand that a human being normally tries to insult another human being with what he is most insecure about himself.
In essence,
ends up telling the entire world what his problems are.
Oh, you're so true, Bob. Everything you say...
You see, Pat, for example, if I was trying to insult you... Well, as a matter of fact, I just did. Small penis. But if I was to continue with that train of thought and trying to insult you, I would suggest to you, sir, that you were not very intelligent. Because that, you see, is my weakness. I fear that I'm not very intelligent. So if I were trying to insult you, that's what I would do. I would say things like, hey, you're stupid. You know, man, you ain't got too many smarts. Because I'm terrified that I'm really stupid and don't have too many smarts.
Well, Bob, everything you say...
So that's the way the human mind works, Pat.
Well, everything you say is right, Bob.
You see, unfortunately, what most people don't understand, and you know, you might want to write this one down because I am a professional insulter, okay? So, unfortunately, what not too many people understand is if you're going to try to insult someone, you've got to do not what gives you pleasure, but what destroys them.
Whatever you say. Whatever you say, Bob.
And then every now and then you get one on the phone or, hell, even in person, who you have gotten to, and who is now so mortified that you've found what the problem is, and that you're, you know, kind of squeezing the old gazungas on him, and he won't go away. He just stands there like a masochist and takes it.
Bob, what the hell are you talking about? I do not understand what the heck you are talking about, Bob. Could you explain it to me?
Just did, Pat.
Okay. Thank you. And, blow hard.
There's only one other thing that makes it all the more worthwhile.
Whatever you say, Bob.
It's when your victim finally does walk away.
Yes, Bob. Whatever you say. And, like I say, I hope you come out and join us, because, you do live in Hyde Park, and, you do hang around Candy Boulevard, and, so I guess you must be a little bit swishy, Bob. Isn't that special? Okay, Bob. Welcome to Tampa, Bob, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you very much, and hang in there, Bob, and try and stay out. I'm trying to be out.
Conducted a little test here at this point in the conversation. Would you, Pat?
Yes, Bob.
Just let me ask all of the men listening to the program at this particular hour,
uh-huh,
at this particular point in time, even.
Yeah.
Men, those of you who are secure in your own sexuality, how much time do you devote in your day to thinking about just exactly what it is that gay people do? Let's go on to Ajax in Gulfport. Ajax, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hey, Bobby. How you doing?
Oh, fine, Ajax. Fine.
My ear is getting warm listening to that guy. You know? But anyway...
Whatever turns you on.
You know what day it is today?
It's Friday.
Yeah. Well, this is a sad day in talk radio, you know.
How's that?
Well, you remember that building at the end of that dirt road?
Yes, they're leaving it today. That's right.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's very sad.
Yeah, moving over to the nice sterile confines of Gateway Center, I guess it is.
Bet you got a lot of memories about that dirt road, huh, Bob?
A lot of memories about the road? I don't know that I would exactly phrase it that way.
Well, I was just thinking, I know there's a lot of people that passed through it. That was a great station at one time.
And I do vividly recall the first time I drove down that dirt road and how horrified I was.
Yeah. Well, I guess that POP is totally buried now. That's it. It's a shame. I always looked at it as an experimental talk station, you know?
Experimental? I think that's the way that the Guy Gannett looked at it, too.
You could get away with a lot of stuff down there.
See, Guy Gannett, unfortunately, they were extremely successful doing talk in Miami.
What happened?
And, well, I'm about to explain that to you. Guy Gannett, one of the big mucky in charge of all the radio stations at Guy Gannett is a man named Bob Gilbertson.
All right.
And Bob just could not, in any shape, manner, or form, deal with success. So they went out and bought WPLP for him, so that he could experiment and see exactly what you had to do to destroy a radio station so that they could take what they learned at PLP and take it to the other stations that they own.
I guess
and destroy them.
It went pretty good.
Yes, it's worked tremendously well at WINZ in Miami, which is now just an absolute pig.
Yesterday I was flipping around the dial in the afternoon,
mm-hmm.
and I came across this new guy they got in the afternoon. Have you heard this guy?
Oh, are you talking about the one abortion, yes or no? Give me a call.
Well,
is that the one you mean?
He's doing your shtick.
Not exactly, my friend.
Well, you know who called him yesterday?
Who's that?
Jacob.
No.
Yeah.
Really?
I couldn't believe it.
Son of a gun.
And he was threatened to boycott the station and everything.
Oh, no.
And this guy just couldn't deal with him.
Oh, you're kidding me.
He just couldn't deal. It was one of the funniest things I've ever heard.
Well, as I had mentioned yesterday during the Hall of Fame nominations, almost everybody who was nominated for either, you know, Caller of the Decade or Worst Caller of the Decade are primarily the people that they're working with over there on the phones, almost without exception. It's astonishing.
That's a sad radio station.
Tragedy is they don't know what the hell to do with them now that they have them. I'd kill for some of those calls.
And then I was flipping around and down. I got this Sarasota station. It's this guy named Rush Bumgarten or something. Did you ever hear of him?
No, I haven't. I've hardly heard of Sarasota.
Unbelievable. If you ever, you know, flipping around a dial, you might catch this guy, but he's like a conservative talk show host or something.
Mm-hmm.
He's not, you know, he must be on one of...
Well, that's the way the guy is over there on the afternoon at Plop. He's a, you know, kind of like a liberal talk show host. He's sort of liberal.
Well, if you're flipping around, catch him because
I mean, I actually heard this man say that he wouldn't have an abortion. He said, you know, I stand for your right to have one, but I'll tell you unequivocally, I personally would not have an abortion. I was very impressed with a guy that comes out and takes a stand like that.
15 minutes I was listening, I couldn't believe it. It was almost as bad as listening to Wheeler. I turned him on the other night, and he was begging for calls. He had the old USA Today paper in front of him. It was totally unbelievable.
Was Jack pretending he knows how to read again?
Yeah, and he only...
Oh, when's he going to give up on that?
The only call that he got was some guy that called up and said, I used to wear clothes like that until I got a job. He had this pink tie on and some kind of horse blanket. And Jack got all offended at that. And that was it.
The only real regret that I have about moving to Hillsborough County is that I no longer get the cable system that carries Mr. Wheeler, Grandfather Wheeler's show.
Well, he said he wouldn't want to be.
Hi, Jack. How you doing?
He said
glad to have you along
be
this afternoon.
Radio anymore. Because
I thought it was talk radio that said that first.
I know that, but yeah. He said everybody talks about sex, politics, and religion, and it just goes around and around in circles.
Yeah. Jack would kill to be in talk radio, but then Jack is. Jack's a guy that has a real tough time telling the truth.
Yeah, we
right, Gramps?
Yep. Hello? Okay, Bob. See you later.
Take care, Ajax.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Off we go to Never Never Land. Talk show host choice. Oh, I see. Jim in Venice. Jim, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Oh, Bob, I want you. I want your juicy thighs.
Dream on, punk. Steve in Temple Terrace. Steve, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
How you doing, Bob?
Oh, fine.
Long time no hear from. Well, from me at least. I called basically to let you in on something. I thought I'd share something kind of special with you. It means something to us out here in the Temple Terrace area. At times when you're, you know, when you're
reaching a point... has nothing to do with a toll road, does it?
Excuse me?
Has nothing to do with a toll road, does it?
No, it has.
Oh, that's good.
I wouldn't want to share that with you. You know all about that. This is something new, something invigorating. And it was actually started up in around Canada, at least that's what we think, and was then perfected by one Richard Lazarus in the area, brought up in a very Jewish family. He resembles a lizard. You're going to meet him real soon, actually. And then also perfected by one Robert Bray. In any case, what it is when you reach a point of indecision, or you see someone do something that's very stupid, or a slip up, or whatever the case may be, and you have no other way to express your feeling of ignorance for them, it's expressed through something called a grunt. Now, I know this sounds odd in the, you know, to begin with, but actually it's a great sense of relief. And if you practice this, Bob, I think you would be a much more relaxed person. Not to say that you aren't already. You might, it's not real loud, but over the phone it might be. And it sounds something like this. You might want to put the phone away so you don't hurt your ear. It sounds a little bit like this. Something like that, but you have to practice it over and over again. And it has different tones. And, it's something that I think if you practice, you could apply to everyday life, Bob.
Steve, how old are you?
Excuse me?
How old are you?
I'm 23.
That's what I thought. Steve, you're talking about something primarily referred to as a primeval screams.
Yes, yes, very much so.
Steve, they go back to the 60s, man.
Well, I wouldn't go back quite that far, but it
is. Well, I know that you don't go back quite that far. It's what I'm telling you, that this new thing, kids today, I mean, I swear they think they invented everything. This new thing, even sex sometimes, this new thing that you're talking about is older than you are.
Really?
Yep.
No.
Oh, man, the Beatles. You know, the Beatles, John Lennon, Yoko Ono, his wife, they were into that stuff 20 years ago.
They were into grunting?
Yeah.
Did you ever grunt, Bob?
Not in that fashion, no.
Have you ever tried?
Well, there were some mornings after consuming more of my chili than I should have that I found myself sitting in the smaller room of the house grunting a great deal, yes, but not for any reason other than to pass the time.
I see. Bob, it would be, now, I know, I practically already know what the answer to this is going to be, but it would mean something very special to me and also to the people that look up to you, idolize you, if I may, in the form of a grunt.
Well, let me see if I can't reconstruct one of those grunts. Let's see, I would go into the room. I would sit down, well, I'll put the seat up.
Okay.
Put the lid up, not the seat, put the lid up. I'd sit there and I'd go kind of...
So it's more of a relieving.
God, what a mess. Oh, Jesus, the chair. Oh.
Was it splashing at the time? Never mind. I don't want to know. Bob, we want to let you know I live with somebody from Canuck, Canada. Mr. Jeffrey TF21 Brady. Who is down here, and he also is an avid listener of yours.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to thank you deeply from the bottom of my heart. A true American grunt was emitted over the airwaves, and I'd like to thank you, sir.
Any time, Steve. Alistair in Tampa. Alistair, you're on the air at 970 WFLA. That's a rather unique approach. Off we go to... Tim in Clearwater. Tim, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Hi, Bob.
Oh, hi, Tim.
How you doing?
Oh, fine.
I'm a working stiff, and I managed to get off a little early today to call in.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm referring to a couple shows where things didn't quite go so well your way, and you got a little upset with the people, so you just started taking crack phone calls.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, what I was referring to is, you know, you made a comment there on one of your shows about closet listeners to Lassiter.
Mm-hmm.
For them to get off their duffs and give you a call so we don't have to listen to this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a lot of us out there working aren't really next to a phone, so, you know, our boss would take get a little angry with us if we went and used the phone on his time.
Well, I think if you're truly a devoted listener, you would quit your day job and get a job at night so that you could listen and participate in the daytime.
No, I can't do that. My wife's got a night job.
Selfish man.
No. But I'm not taking anything against those shows. I mean, those are really funny when people come in and just, you know, make strange noises and stuff. Like the show that you wanted to talk about and everybody kept talking about the Red Sox or the White Sox coming down. So all you took was White Sox callers.
Right.
Yeah. Well, that was a real funny show, and, you know, my partner and I laughed all the way through it. But, like I said, we can't get to a phone to call you. So,
Well, if you were really sincere, you'd quit your job and get a job at night.
I can't
stand on the issue today.
Hello, Bob. How you doing?
Fine, Glenn. Where do you stand on the issue today?
I was going to ask you about something else. I wanted to ask you about Bush's 1,000 points of light, if you could tell me what that is.
Glenn, have you been listening to the show?
No, I haven't.
Well, Glenn, we were responding today to an article that appeared in this morning's St. Petersburg Times. The article on the front page of the second section that talked about how it has been discovered that in order to save money at the new stadium in St. Petersburg, they are only going to have unisex bathrooms with urinals on one wall and toilets on the other with a large sign asking you please not to look at members of the opposite sex.
Is that right?
And this is what we've been talking about this afternoon, Glenn. How do you feel about that? Would you be intimidated going into such a bathroom?
Yeah, I think so.
Do you think that the city of St. Petersburg should spend the money to have separate facilities for males and females?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Glenn. We'll put you down as being opposed to that new program over there. See, we knew in advance that he wasn't listening to the show, and that's why we thought we'd have a little fun with him. Mike in Reddington Shores, please. There was no such article in the St. Petersburg Times today. Mike in Reddington Shores. Hi, Mike. You're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Yeah, how you doing, Bob?
Fine, thank you.
I'd like to respond to that, if I may, even if there wasn't an article in the St. Pete Times. I think it's a great idea. I think I'd be a little intimidated at first. But
well, I wouldn't trust the girls not to look.
I was thinking about myself, but I think I'd get used to it just as I think the women would. Anyway, I thought you might be interested to know about the traffic jam up in Richmond, Virginia.
The traffic jam in Richmond, Virginia?
Only in the southbound lanes on 95. The toll booth, they have two of them up there going through Richmond.
Yes, yes, I'd forgotten all about that. Yes, the people in Virginia are sometimes almost as creative in raising money as the citizens in Florida are.
Yeah, but they don't even have a lottery. I don't think it's moral.
Sir, living in Virginia and not being a native Virginian is in and of itself playing a lottery.
Yes, you're right.
At least you'd be discovered not to be a bare minimum seventh generation Virginian.
Listen, so let me elaborate on the traffic jam. I finally made it up to the booth. I didn't have the proper change, so I had to get change. And I asked the guy what the problem was, and he said that the machines were all backed up with Canadian quarters, that they hadn't gotten the state-of-the-art toll booth correct change baskets.
Mm-hmm.
And that they were malfunctioning because of the Canadian quarters. I thought you might be interested.
Well, in that particular case, having formerly lived in Richmond, Virginia, uh-huh. For about, I think I was there for about 2.5 years, having formerly lived there, I cannot think of anything that I could find to complain about Canadians dumping quarters in their machines.
There were also quite a number of...
Matter of fact, I applaud the practice.
You applaud the practice?
Yes, I do.
Functioning their machines?
Yes, I do.
I bet that people who know of that situation that you're talking about might have done it on purpose.
As a matter of fact, I hereby encourage anyone traveling north to save a couple of Canadian quarters to toss in their change baskets outside of Richmond. The rest of Virginia is a fantastic state. I love the state of Virginia. But the city of Richmond and its immediate environs is an absolute hellhole to live in if you are not a native son of the South.
Could you tell me why in like 10 words or less?
Why? Because there are an awful lot of people, and I mean this seriously, and it is true.
Uh-huh.
There are an awful lot of people who live in Richmond who feel that anyone who isn't a bare minimum seventh generation son of the Confederacy is not worth associating with. It's a hell of a town to be an outsider in. It's an impossible town.
I had never heard that before.
Oh, and it's a beautiful, beautiful city, too. I mean, it is a dynamite city, except the attitude there is unreal.
What, a lot of, rednecks, or...?
No, these are not rednecks. These are just... sons of the Confederacy, people who are still a little bit pissed about the war.
Jesus Christ.
I'm serious, man.
Oh, man.
There is a street in Richmond, one of the most beautiful boulevards in the entire country, called Monument Boulevard.
Mm-hmm.
And on Monument Boulevard is something like 11, 12, 13, 14 gigantic, beautiful statues of various different Confederate generals. Confederate cemeteries. Obviously, Richmond was the capital of the Confederacy.
Right.
As a matter of fact, just last week, or was it the week before, they reopened the restored Confederate White House.
Huh.
It's a beautiful city. There's a wild river that runs right through the heart of Richmond, Virginia, the James
River.
Yes, it turns into a navigable river right below Richmond, but through Richmond, it's a wild whitewater river. It's a gorgeous place.
Oh, is that right?
Oh, beautiful homes. But miserable people. Ah.
Well, let me elaborate on the traffic jam just one little bit first.
Sure.
This is true. There were quite a few Michigan plates on South 95 there, and I thought, you might be interested to know that. Why
Michigan plates
Michigan
on 95 South?
Michigan taking 95 South, obviously, to Florida, because I saw them all the way down.
I couldn't begin to imagine.
I thought maybe they were lost. Doesn't I-75 go right through Michigan or in that area?
Well, it's a hell of a lot easier. I'm not sure where exactly I-75 goes, except that it does run up, for example, through Cincinnati.
Uh-huh.
And it's a hell of a lot easier to pick up 75 than it is 95 from Michigan. And it's not exactly the time of the year when tourism is real big in, you know, Philadelphia or Washington.
Right, right. Well, listen, you brought up Philadelphia, and I wanted to tell you, I heard your show yesterday. You wanted to get people responding to the best show that they've heard. One of the most memorable things that I've ever heard you talk about, probably, I don't even think it was mentioned yesterday, but it was your very vivid description of what it was like to go to a baseball game in Philadelphia when you were young and not really caring who won, but the idea of going there and seeing the grass and the...
Well, you must understand at that point in my life and at that point in the Philadelphia Phillies history, it was best not to care who won so you wouldn't be disappointed.
Yeah, well, I was a Washington Senators fan.
Oh, I'm
that's where
so
I grew up.
Sorry.
It was the same kind of thing.
Yes,
I didn't really care who won for the same reason that you didn't care who won. And it just gave me a better outlook on the game. I just enjoyed the game, the atmosphere, the smell of the hot dogs, people having a good time.
Yeah, I won't watch just any game on television, but I would go see just any game. Because watching it at the ballpark is a whole different trip.
Mm-hmm. It definitely is. It's a real experience, especially for a six-year-old, to go up the ramps and go out into the stadium itself and look at those gods down on the field. It's unbelievable. It's something just totally out of one's imagination.
Mm. Poor girls, they don't know what we're talking about.
Right. Well, they might. My sister did. Let me ask you one other thing.
What's that?
About 2 months ago, somebody called up and asked you if you would like to listen to a rap song that he created. And I heard it, and I thought it was pretty good, and he said that he would, you know, you asked him to do something. He said he would mail you a tape of it or something.
He didn't.
He did?
Didn't, no.
He did not?
No.
Oh, I thought it was really good.
So did I.
And he never followed through?
Nope.
Huh. This is a moment of glory there.
He probably sent it to Eastman or something.
Oh, really?
He probably got mad at me and sent it to Eastman.
Or Jack Ellery. Maybe he took it with him.
Hey, that's a possibility. Has Ellery been playing any rap music? Over on his show? No, not Ellery.
No, he probably doesn't know what rap is. And anyway, the other thing is the Continental Deli. I wanted to ask you. I've never heard of it. I go to Ybor City every now and then.
It's right on 7th Avenue. I think it's between 17th and 18th.
7th Avenue between 17th and 18th.
Uh-huh.
Great.
Fantastic.
I'll have to remember.
They're open
that.
From early in the morning till about 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Okay. And they're open on Sunday, do you know?
No, they're not open on Sunday. That's one day they close.
Okay. Well, there's a big
arts and crafts
thing for Christmas they have every year over there, probably coming up pretty soon. So we're going to be going over there. I thought, you know, it would take that in.
It's well worth it.
Well, I appreciate it.
Be good.
Thanks a lot, Bob.
Take care. WFLA.
Hello there.
Hi.
How are you today?
Oh, great.
I guess we're getting down to the wire here.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to talk a little bit about traffic, but now something else came up on my mind here. Oat brand. This is driving me crazy. Oat brand.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a person that's trying to watch cholesterol, as everyone else is, or a good portion of America is. The labeling and what we're eating, I don't know what to believe. Something that says zero cholesterol, and then there's multi-ingredient labels, which will give you the indication that it may contain other soluble fats.
What were you going to say about traffic?
I don't know what I was going to say. It just makes me angry.
Makes you angry.
The traffic just makes me very, very angry.
Mm.
And Oat Brand makes me angry. I'm that kind of a person. And I think it goes hand in hand. First, I have Oat Brand, and then I get into the traffic. And I think there's a relationship there.
You think there's a relationship?
There's a relationship between Oat Brand and the traffic.
Well, in fact, it is true that the Department of Transportation is using Oat Brand in road paving in some areas.
Oh. I thought that was what was happening.
Mm-hmm. What happens, of course, is that there is a carcinogenic relationship between the rubber scrubbed off of truck tires and the Oat Brand that leaches out of the asphalt.
Isn't that interesting? Is that going on just here in Tampa?
No, there are other areas. In fact, there is a correlation between all of this and the number of people who did not vote for the Senate race.
Oh, so there's a political involvement.
Yeah, there is a political involvement, and there is an investigation going on as to whether or not it is a Republican plot to put the Oat Brand in the asphalt.
Does anyone else know this?
Well, no. I've been doing extensive research on it, but I wasn't quite ready to release the findings until now. But being as how you've already started to talk about it, why, I guess it is time that we did get into it now.
Hope that clears up the whole mess for you, Gary. Thanks a lot. Norman, do you really think that what they had in mind when they took precious dollars from the promotion budget and bought those Z93 T-shirts was a middle-aged, somewhat portly man who should never wear T-shirts walking around in a T-shirt that says Z93 on it?
I mean,
I would think that these people, if you really wanted a T-shirt, I would think that these people here could get really your Q105 T-shirt.
Now, you've really hurt me now, Bob. You really have. You've really injured my pride, actually.
Injured your pride? I was thinking about the image of the station across the hall.
You've hurt me now, see. I got the polyester pants, too. And the.
I mean, I never wear a T-shirt. I don't wear T-shirts for a good reason. Because I look like
you
Helen
can't
T-shirts.
Get one
you
in
know,
that
I'm,
size. It's the real
you know,
thing.
I'm a fat middle-aged man, too.
Well, I wanted to show off my hairy chest, actually, is the reason that I did it.
Well, you know, couldn't you just carry a picture around from your younger days?
No, there's more hair there now.
It
shows up better because it's white.
Picture?
You know, the hair shows up better now that it's white.
You have white hair on your chest?
Mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm. My pubic hair is turning gray, too. Would you like to see, Bob?
I don't believe you.
You're sure about that?
I don't believe you.
It's true.
Prove it. Well, that's the hair on your chest.
Well, we'll get to the others later during the news.
Oh, how exciting.
I know that.
Oh, let's see here. Green Swamp Bill. Green Swamp, you're on the air at 970 WFLA.
Good afternoon, Bob. How you doing?
Well, I don't know. A great deal could depend on this call, Green.
I'll tell you what, Uncle Dickie, I've seen him before, and the Z93 on his shirt is good advertisement because his belly's so big. That it really stands out good.
Well, you see, they're trying to give the impression, the image over there of a hip, cool station where hip, cool people listen to it. And, you know, they would like large-breasted women to wear them. They would like men with small tushes and narrow waists and flat tummies to wear them. But I just don't really think when they put out the money, these are very expensive shirts. I just don't really think that, you know, it's Norman that they had in mind.
Hey, I'm a mature Bill Murray.
Uncle Biggie.
Yeah, mature Bill Murray. Bill Murray has a small tush and a flat stomach.
Oh, really? You haven't seen Bill Murray in his latest film?
Oh, Bill, I was thinking of Bill Murphy.
My question is, why were you thinking of Bill Murphy?
Don't be careful, Bob.
God, I'm just going to put the whistle in the...
Hey, Bob.
Just packing up. Yeah, yeah.
I just wanted to, I couldn't call yesterday. I would want to vote for Lutz, the Hall of Fame.
Uh-huh.